now, the greatest radio shows of all time.
Suspense.
The Shadow Node.
Washington calling David Harding, counter-spy.
Classic radio theater.
The Great Gildersleeve.
Fibber McGee and Molly.
Dragnet. Gunsmoke.
The Lone Ranger.
Now step back into our time machine with your host, Wyatt Cox.
Good evening, friends of the Inner Sanctum.
Well, we've made it through the first week of the new year, and we're going to make it through with some more crime today. William Gargan, sad story about his personal life, but a great show. Barrie Craig Confidential Investigator from 69 years ago. Mr. Keen, Tracer of Lost Persons, the fine Bennett Kilpack in that. Frank Sinatra as Rocky Fortune, his one and only starring radio series that wasn't singing. Broadway Is My Beat, starring Larry Thor and Lovin' Abner. That's all straight ahead. I want to salute Eric, a very nice fellow who bought me a copy at classicradio.stream, and he was very, very generous. He paid for the 12-pack that's coming. I ordered through Amazon a 12-pack of Dr. Pepper. And why would I order it through Amazon? Because it was sugar. You know, and that's one of the things that I always get to, is that you look at most of the soda these days, it doesn't have sugar in it. It has high fructose corn syrup, which is not as good for you. And I know this is an entertainment show. This is not a medical show. But I have to tell you that over the years, high fructose corn syrup has not done me well. Especially the last 10-15 years. And so I have found products that I enjoy that have real sugar in them. That's really nice. So I ordered that, and thank you, Eric, for your generous contribution to the podcast. And we are here on a Friday, fifth day of January, the fifth day of the year, of course, 361 days till we get to 2025, I should say. This is a marriage anniversary. George Washington married Martha Dandridge Custis on this date in 1751. Richmond, Virginia, burned by British naval forces on this date in 1781, led by Benedict Arnold. The House voted to stop sharing the Oregon Territory with the UK in 1846. 1896, an Austrian newspaper reported William Rogin discovered a type of radiation that would become known as X-rays. Ford Motor Company announced on this date in 1914 an 8-hour workday and a minimum wage of $5 for a day's labor, 62.5 cents an hour. That $5 today would be $158.35 for a day's labor, which is still low, but, you know, beats $5. 1919, Free Committee for a German Workers' Peace was founded. That would become the Nazi Party. 1933, construction of the Golden Gate Bridge in San Francisco Bay began. In 1940, FM radio demonstrated to the Federal Communications Commission for the first time. 1948, Warner Brothers showed the first color newsreel, the Tournament of Roses parade, and the Rose Bowl. What better way to show off the technology of color, you know? 1949, President Truman outlined his series of social and economic reforms known as the Fair Deal.
This is the task before us. It is not an easy one. It has many complications, and there will be strong opposition from selfish interests. I hope for cooperation from farmers, from labor, and from business. Every segment of our population and every individual have a right to expect from our government a fair deal.
Among the planks of Truman's Fair Deal included economic controls to halt inflation, a more progressive tax structure, the raising of the minimum wage, repeal of the Taft-Hartley Act, which restricted labor unions, agricultural reform, resource development and public power, national medical insurance. Yes, Obamacare was not new. It went back to the Truman administration. Also, expansion of Social Security, federal housing programs, aid to education, and civil rights protection. The aims of the Fair Deal aim to give all Americans access to education, health care, and good jobs. Now, in 1964, appearing on the Ed Sullivan Show on this date, the singing nun.
Dominique, nique, nique, s'en allait tout simplement. Routier, pauvre et chantant. En tout chemin, en tout lieu, il ne parle que du bon Dieu. Il ne parle que du bon Dieu. À l'époque où Jean sans terre d'Angleterre était le roi, Dominique, notre père, combattit les albigeois. Dominique, nique, nique, s'en allait tout simplement. Routier, pauvre et chantant. En tout chemin, en tout lieu, il ne parle que du bon Dieu, il ne parle que du bon Dieu.
Certains jours, un hérétique par des ronces le conduit, mais notre père Dominique par sa joie le convertit.
Dominique, nique, nique, s'en allait tout simplement, routier, pauvre et chantant. En tout chemin, en tout lieu, il ne parle que du bon Dieu, il ne parle que du bon Dieu.
Sister Smile, as she was referred to, sang that song Dominique, which was the first and only Belgian song to be a number one hit in the United States. The soap opera All My Children premiered on this date in 1972. And in 70, I should say, in 1970 is when All My Children premiered. In 1972, though, President Nixon ordered the development of a space shuttle program.
This decision by the president is a most historic step in the history of the space program, in that it gives man for the first time the capability of routinely and at a moment's notice when necessary of getting to and from space with either men or equipment.
Economics, basically, are what killed the space shuttle program. While it did run for 20 years, it was scrapped in 2011 after two major disasters. And part of the reason was because the upgrades that needed to be made weren't made. Technology was used that was very old. And the fact that the program continued as well with only those disasters, that is amazing in and of itself. Had they done more upgrades, built new shuttles, and kept technology abreast, it probably would have been continuing to this date. Now, in 1997, Russian forces withdrew from Chechnya. That was in 1997. Among those passing away on this date in history, Calvin Coolidge, the 30th President of the United States, educator George Washington Carver, the fine actor Hans Conried, actor Arthur Kennedy, Tip O'Neill, Sonny Bono, and Pistol Pete Maravich.
Maravich, driven, Maravich, from 35 feet away, scores! He tied the record! He tied the record at 754 in the ball game.
Maravich's record score, interestingly enough, he was playing a pickup basketball game in a Pasadena gym, died of heart failure. 40 years of age. Born on this date in history, actor George Reeves, actress Jane Wyman, music producer Sam Phillips, politician Walter Mondale, and Wilbert Harrison, all born on this date in history. They are no longer with us.
Hi, this is Jeff Foxworthy. It is now time for the birthday announcements. The following people are now officially older than dirt.
Robert Duvall, 93 years old today. Diane Keaton is 78. Isaac on the Love Boat. Ted Lang, 76. From Nancy Drew on television and Dynasty, Pamela Sue Martin, 71. Singer Marilyn Manson, 55 years of age. From A Star is Born, Bradley Cooper is 44. From Mad Men, January Jones is 46. DJ Deadmau5, spelled Deadmau5, D-E-A-D-M-A-U-5, Deadmau5, 43, I don't know. And from Laguna Beach, Kristen Cavallari is 37. Those just a few of the people celebrating the 5th day of January is their birthday. And if this happens to be your birthday,
happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, happy birthday. Happy birthday to you.
Crime drama for the next 2 hours, starting off with William Gargan as Barrie Craig Confidential Investigator. That's up next here on this Friday, Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox.
They say neither snow, nor rain, nor heat, nor gloom of night.
Neither snow, nor rain, nor heat, nor gloom of night will hold up your mail. But you can if you don't use zip codes. Be sure to use zip code on every letter and package you send, and always include your own zip code in your return address. That way, others will have it when they write to you. Remember, mail moves the country, and zip code moves the mail.
Oh, trash cans, dogs. At least a zip code.
Classic Radio Theater with me, Wyatt Cox. Thank you so much for making us a part of your Friday. William Gargan now, Barrie Craig Confidential Investigator. This episode was originally broadcast 69 years ago, January 5th, 1955, The Angel of Death.
William Gargan stars as Barrie Craig Confidential Investigator.
It's okay to cut a competitor down a few notches, but never cut him 6 feet lower than the soles of his feet. That's no longer fair competition, folks. That's murder.
The National Broadcasting Company presents William Gargan in another transcribed drama of mystery and adventure with America's number one detective, Barrie Craig, Confidential Investigator.
Barrie Craig speaking. One way of landing a client is to fish him out of the river, which is exactly how I commenced my confidential file in a character named Richie Stimson. I jumped with my shoes on. I found Stimson's hat before I found Stimson. Nobody rescues a hat, so I didn't. When Stimson finally bobbed into reach, he promptly stuck one thumb in my eye and the remaining one in my jugular vein. Another thing nobody wants to do is drown in a stranger's embrace. When his jaw came up flush with the surface, I landed on it. He lay quietly on his back now, spouting water from the mouth like Moby Dick. And I began floating him to shore. On shore, the closest shelter we could find was a junk dealer's basement store. I stuck Moby Dick right up against the stove so he could dry out. Stand there till the icicles melt, Buster. Then I got my shoes off. Oh, squish. I'd been really walking in canal boats. Rescue a guy from drowning, you expect his first speech to be, thank you, but not this joker.
My car. Hey, what about my car?
Oh, I'm keeping it as a souvenir of the occasion.
Hey, it's a brand new job.
The fish will be pleased to know. Lean close a minute, Buster.
Lean?
That's close enough. I want to smell your breath.
I wasn't drunk going through that guardrail. Get that idea out of your head.
Just lousy driving, huh?
Yeah, it's coming back to me now.
What is?
That same feeling I've been getting lately. Dopey all of a sudden. And the blues, like I'm depressed.
Up here, something starts fogging up.
In your head?
Yeah, yeah. Makes me want to shut my eyes, like I've been on a weekend toot, and now I gotta sleep.
And do you shut your eyes?
I don't know.
Buster.
What?
Confidentially, who are you?
Richie Stimson.
Chauffeur, used to be. And now?
A husband.
That's, your occupation?
Yeah, that is.
Oh.
Who are you?
Barrie Craig. I'm a detective.
Well, you know.
And, where can I bill you?
Bill me for what?
A suit of clothes, look.
Oh, yes, torn. Hey, you sure it wasn't torn before?
Now, that's what I call gratitude.
472 and 1/2 Park Avenue. Send me the numbers and I'll write out a check.
Where? Park Avenue?
Ah, what's the surprise?
Boy, your kisser, it's got 10th Avenue on it.
So I moved east 7 blocks.
So you married east 7 blocks. I mailed Stimson my bill for a suit of clothes and a new pair of shoes. And surprise of surprises, I got a prompt reply in the return mail. Addressee's name on it, Stimson, with the Park Avenue address. Well, there was a check in it, but not exactly for $100 I had politely requested. The check had an extra zero on it, $1,000. Check signed, Natalie Stimson. I read the short note that came with it. Dear Mr. Craig, a small token of my gratitude for the wonderful thing you did for my husband. Signed, Mrs. Natalie Stimson. And there was a postscript. I would very much like to meet you at your convenience. $1,000 was the most elegant persuasion I knew. Information? I'd like the phone number of a golden angel. Her name? Oh. Mrs. Natalie Stimson. 472 and a half, Park Avenue. We met at a rendezvous at the lady's insistence, not mine. An out-of-the-way, private, for members only joint called the Club Socrates, where people dined lying down on couches like the old Roman nobility. The maitre d'hotel wore a toga, and the slant-eyed waitresses were all made up to resemble Cleopatra. Natalie tried to clear up my confusion.
It's a revival of old Roman dining habits, Barry. It's the newest fad.
Imagine.
It restores eating to what it should be.
And what's that?
Well, life's most gratifying experience. A sheerly exotic...
Enough said.
So, kick your shoes off, lie back on the couch, and luxuriate. Really enjoy it, Barry.
So tell me.
Tell you?
Why we're wallowing here.
Oh, I want to talk to you about Richie.
Oh, your ex-chauffeur and present husband. It's his unaccountable depressions. You worry over them.
Richie's told you about them?
You sound surprised.
Well, I am, for Richie to confide so quickly.
Well, I'm a guy people right away confide in. He says he gets, dopey all of a sudden. Gets the booze. Becomes, depressed. And then up here in the beans, something starts fogging up, unquote.
His reflexes go awry. He loses sense and coordination. I've seen it happen time and again.
Well, give me an example.
What? Well, in entering my dad's brokerage office some weeks ago, Richie burst through the door but continued going across the room. He didn't stop at Dad's desk.
And where did he continue on to?
Right through the window.
How far did he fall?
2 stories. The miracle was he landed on a terrace on the 26th story.
Otherwise, 28 floors to the sidewalk.
Otherwise, a horrible death. What do you make of it?
Well, I could go medical and call it an unconscious suicide wish, but I won't say it.
Then what do you say?
I say hand Richie over to a doctor.
But he's been to doctors.
Doctors in the plural?
Well, 6 doctors this year.
Well, what did the last chap say?
That Richie's a normal neurotic.
Yet he's accident prone.
Accident prone. Those are exactly the words the other fellow, the lay analyst, used.
So keep him under glass. Don't let him roam around.
Now, is that practical advice?
Maybe not. Now, besides sympathy, what do you want of me?
I want you to be Richie's man friend.
Come again?
You see, I've got my own theory about Richie.
That being?
That he's a cat in a strange alley. He needs someone around he can feel at home with. Someone who talks his language.
Same being a slob like me, huh?
I'll pay $1,000 a week.
For me to chum around with Richie?
Room with him. Play gin rummy with him. Go off to burlesque shows. All the things Richie used to enjoy doing.
And for how long am I Damon to his Pythias?
1 month. 1 month for $4,000.
Sold.
And you'll do it?
For $4,000, I'd swim underwater to Siam. And that's how I came to move over to Park Avenue. But not without protests from my newfound buddy.
Get your hat and scram out of here.
I do that, I'm unemployed.
Hey, who's paying you? My father-in-law?
I haven't met him yet.
Natalie?
Natalie.
So, Natalie hires you to watch over me, huh?
Oh, you got that wife in a million.
Hey, what's Natalie paying you?
Oh, a mere $1,000 a week.
$500.
What happened to my other $5?
I just cut in for it.
You did?
Yeah. I could use more dough. They're keeping me on short rations.
And if I get stubborn about my whole $1,000?
We're not best friends no more. You run out of here like a thief. You're unemployed. Bum. Okay?
Okay, partner.
I'll give you a horse. You run your $5 back to $1,000.
Decent of you.
Hey, what do we do today?
Anybody for the zoo?
Zoo, my eye. Hey, I know what.
So do I.
Oh, hey, you're not a mind reader.
Your mind reads easy. The Crescent Burlesque House over in Hoboken.
What do you know? You are a mind reader at that.
That was the chauffeur turned blue blood in one of his optimistic moods. I also got him in his pessimistic moods. And right on top of breakfast.
Hey, the fox coming up. It's beating at my eyeballs.
You're depressed today.
I feel lousy. Boy, how lousy I feel.
Hating the world and yourself?
Yeah. Yeah, that's one way of putting it. Hey, will you look? I can't even tie my shoelaces.
Hand shaking?
Yeah, like that head mama over at the Crescent last night.
Reflexes all shot, huh?
Who knows about reflexes?
Now, look, hold one arm out straight in front of you.
Huh? Okay. Now what?
Close your eyes.
So they're closed.
Now bring a finger back and touch the tip of your nose.
Touch the tip? Oh!
Trouble?
I jabbed my finger in my eye.
Couldn't find your own nose, huh?
Hey, what does that mean?
Your coordination's off.
Way off?
Way, way off.
Hey, what does it to me, huh?
Well, ask a doctor.
Well, I've been to doctors. I've been tapped with little hammers, x-rayed. I've been laying on couches and talking myself hoarse.
Talking about what?
Oh, anything that came in my head. Psychiatry, this was. About kid days, my old lady. The time Lefty Louie came at me with a butcher knife. Over broad, this was. And, about Miss Curran.
Miss Curran?
Yeah, my teacher, 4B. I used to dream about her a lot. I figured to marry her when I grew up.
So why didn't you?
Well, at the time I was in 4B, she was 72. No, what I got in for doctors, I tried them. Hey, what we do today, huh?
We'll stay indoors and play gin. Leave us not tempt your reflexes. Richie had been to doctors, but I hadn't. So I tried one, an old friend. He'd roomed with my aunt once while serving his internship. Dr. Dinglespieler. A nice little guy who kept his beard buttoned in his vest.
You say he has been to doctors?
6. He's run the gamut, from cardiography to psychoanalysis.
Well, it is very strange that there was no recommended therapy. The symptomology seems to be clear.
Meaning?
The disorientation. The damage to the nervous system.
Talk to me in English, not Greek.
Either the man has a detectable nervous disorder or he is in a psychosis.
As simple as that. I mean, medically speaking. A good physician should see what bothers Richie Stimson by eye. A head doctor could do it by ear.
Yeah, that's right.
Absolutely apple pie for a doctor to diagnose.
Now, look, apple pie is for the cook and the kitchen.
Okay, then say easy to diagnose.
There is perhaps one simple conclusion to come to. Speaking for the doctors, I mean.
And that is?
That your friend had none of these symptoms you have described at precisely those times when the doctors examined him.
Had none of the symptoms at the time of examination?
Yeah.
I'll need time to figure that one out, Doc. Tell me, which branch of medicine is more apt to be mistaken?
The nerve specialist can be sure.
Meaning the head doctor has a bigger margin of error.
Well, psychic sickness is a more experimental medicine. It is, shall we say, in a stage of development.
And Richie Stimson is in a stage of disintegration. Well, thanks for your time, Doc. If I said I wasn't twice as confused as when I came in, I'd be lying. Well, so long. I trotted myself over to 10th Avenue for a peek into Richie Stimson's background. A look into his case history, as the science books put it. I figured out a chat with his folks, if he had any, or his neighborhood priest. But I found a brother. The lettering on the window of the fish store read, Waldo Stimson, Fresh Fish. I found Waldo in a bloody apron, chopping away at a sea monster that looked like a barracuda. Now, stop chopping, and let's talk about your brother, Richie.
Richie, I got one word that ends a conversation.
And the word?
Snob.
He's been high-hatting you?
Box that snazzy car of his in front of my fish store and sits behind a wheel smoking a cigar. The louse just sits out there, rubbing it in.
Rubbing what in?
The box. How he's got him, and I ain't.
Oh. Answer a question or two for me, huh?
Shoot.
Was Richie physically fit?
Strong as a bull. You should have seen how he broke Dobie Delahanty's jaw. Bang, one sock.
Well, was he subject to headaches and accidents?
I don't get you.
Did he ever fall over his own feet, or fall down the stairs, walk into a plate glass window?
Richie, not on your life, bub. Kind of moving around, he was 200%. Champ basketball player and ice hockey. Why, the pros were hustling him to sign a contract.
Then generally well-coordinated. Sharp eyesight and the rest of it?
Sharp eyesight? You saw the chick he grabbed off himself.
Yeah, upper-class Natalie. Well, tell me, how do you figure he swung that?
Well, come to making out, Richie was a conniver. There wasn't a day he didn't have a scheme going for himself.
Shady or strictly legit?
Both ways, depending. Any way Richie could better himself, why, that was it. Hey, look, you're taking up my time. I got fish to sell.
You got a 3-pound Siberian herring?
Siberian herring? What do you know? I'm fresh out of them.
That led me to the father-in-law, C. Lindsay Bernard, broker. I wanted to know how come the uppercase Bernard had sanctioned his daughter's marriage to the family chauffeur. I found Bernard, senior, behind a mahogany desk the size of a tennis court. The cigar in his mouth almost reached out into the hall to the elevator.
Yes, your question, Craig, has definite point. But not with me.
Well, why not?
There's no snobbery in the veins of C. Lindsay Bernard. Not a drop of it, sir. We're a tribe of great commoners. Why, my father cleaned sewers, and his father sold pots and pans along the Great American Highway.
Then you approved of Richie Stimson?
Oh, heartily, sir. You might say I cheered him up that middle aisle to the marriage altar. I favored Richie over Byron Follansbe. Yes, sir, a red-blooded young man like Richie. Why, I abetted his cause with Natalie. I am against the rich inbreeding with the rich. Very bad for progeny. Transmits white blood cells. Offsprings are anemic.
Cut. My ears are bent. While we're on this high-level talk, a quotation comes to my head. Something we used to recite in school, Mr. Bernard, from Shakespeare.
Oh, always a pleasure to hear Shakespeare quoted. The quotations, huh?
Methinks you plead too hard.
Is that a sneer at my veracity?
It could be.
Why, you foul-mouthed, low-born peasant.
And a minute ago, you were the guy advertising himself as the great commoner. From Bernard Sr.'s office, I drove back to Park Avenue to resume with Richie Stimson. We had big plans for the evening. A repeat of the night before the night before. The Crescent Burlesque over in Hoboken. At 472 and a half Park Avenue, I found Richie already downstairs on the street. On the sidewalk, a few feet away from the big front door canopy. Top hat on him and tails, as if he couldn't wait to get going to Hoboken. Only thing, he was the last guy I'd want to be seen out with. Not the condition he was in. Flat on his back with a seepage of blood dyeing his clothes red. A crowd of morbid gapers packed around him and an ambulance on its way to the scene. No, sir, no date. I couldn't see myself watching a girly show with a corpse. One byproduct of death you can be absolutely sure of is a widow's tears.
Richie.
And Natalie sure wept, tears cascading down her until the little chiffon item she was wearing clung to her like a bathing suit after a dip in the ocean. A show of grief in a bereaved father-in-law comes harder. Either it's unmanly to cry or see Lindsay Bernard was a Phi Beta Kapper in the art of self-control. The only thing that occurred to him to do was abuse me.
Richie died because of your negligence, Craig. Your default of duty. You weren't hired to gad about making ridiculous inquiries. You had explicit duties. You were paid to stay with Richie. Never let him out of your sight.
The guy is slated to walk off an outside terrace 18 stories up. Comes a time when he does it. There's only one chap really watching him 24 hours a day.
One chap?
The Angel of Death. A brother of the deceased can usually muster a tear or two.
Poor kid.
Death softened you toward your brother Richie, huh?
Yeah. Yeah, I ain't got no hard feelings now. Who she set up like this here? Look at them drapes and that chandelier. Imagine walking out on it.
Walking off a terrace into space 18 stories over the sidewalk.
Yeah. What a way to go.
Your beautifully coordinated brother. A kid with sharp eyesight and trained reflexes.
Oh, about that, I didn't exactly feature the right dope on Richie then. That time we talked, I sort of left something out.
You did?
Yeah, you know, something that came back to mind. You see, Richie was a big one for accidents. All the time falling down cellars or fire escapes. And your pains here in the head, always with a wet towel and the ice pack on his bean. You get me, huh?
Better than you think, Waldo. Tell me something.
What?
Who's paying you to lie to me and how much are you getting?
Well, suppose I am in the way of a few bucks. No harm to nobody. Why should I pass it up?
Because your brother was set up to accidentally kill himself. Or be murdered.
Murdered? Now, how could that be?
Say, a push off that terrace.
But you don't know that.
No, I don't. But pushed or fell, either way, it's murder.
But he'd been dopey all the time, tripping over his own feet. You yourself told me that.
Yeah, dopey and so forth. And I've got an explanation for that.
What?
Drugs. Somebody's been feeding Richie drugs in his drink and in his food. Drugs that work havoc on his reflexes for a time, then dissipate into the bloodstream. So that he seems okay during medical examinations.
Yeah, but who be feeding him drugs?
Who offered you a bribe to suddenly remember that Richie was accident-prone?
Two of them did. Natalie and her old man.
I only got a piece of the truth from Natalie.
I didn't marry Richie. He married me.
What was the blackmail threat that got you to say yes?
As my father's chauffeur, he...
Got something on your father? Some business irregularity your father could be liable to prosecution for, that it? Okay. Clam up pending advice of counsel. I'm content to let the whole story wait on the autopsy.
The autopsy?
The one I'm ordering to be done immediately. to determine the nature of the drug that got Richie drowsy and dopey enough to walk off that terrace into cold space. This one hasn't had time yet to really dissipate into the bloodstream, beautiful.
I will say never hire you.
People are all the time hiring me as a cover for their cute operations. I can be hired, baby, but not bought. Hired, but not bought. I'm sure you understand the difference. You've been to college.
You have been listening to William Gargan in another exciting transcribed mystery drama from the adventures of Barrie Craig, Confidential Investigator. Tonight's story, Angel of Death, was written by John Robert. Next week, it's the strange story of the man who died by himself, about which Barrie Craig has this to say. We call next week's story The Man Who Died by Himself. Among other things, and corpses, it deals with a fortune teller, a fortune, and a beautiful girl. And, of course, the man who died by himself, except he wasn't entirely alone. He had a killer for company. The National Broadcasting Company has just brought you an NBC Radio Network production with William Gargan starring as Barrie Craig, Confidential Investigator. Directed by Arthur Jacobson. Cast included Paul Duboff, Betty Lou Gerson, Jack Carroll, and Jack Moyles. This is John Lang speaking. Join Groucho Marx for You Bet Your Life tonight on the NBC Radio Network.
You know, I always wondered about William Gargan and why I knew so little of him, and I found out, and it was sad. William Gargan had great contracts all through his life. NBC wanted him on a number of productions. He was going to go on stage. And problem is, in 1960, he had a bout with laryngitis. Doctors did some tests on his throat. Throat cancer. They removed his larynx. A breathing stoma cut into the bottom of his throat so he could breathe, and for a time he was very depressed. He eventually fought his way through it and learned how to speak, believe it or not, very much the way he did, but he never got back to the limelight. He formed William Gargan Productions, making traditional films and television shows in Hollywood. Gargan, an amazing performer. We enjoy his stuff. And he suffered a heart attack in 1979 and pronounced dead. William Gargan, Barrie Craig, Confidential Investigator. Some people say I get too depressed over this stuff. Talk depressing about how people die. Well, you know, people die. And you deserve to know how some people who did amazing work on radio and in motion pictures passed away. That's how Barrie Craig died, or William Gargan died. Barrie Craig, Confidential Investigator, 69 years ago, January 5th, 1955. Up next, Bennett Kilpack as Mr. Keene, Tracer of Lost Persons on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox.
My true love's many faces, many places you see. The city, the country, the sea. Wherever my true love may take it to be. Now zip code will find her for me. Wherever my true love may take it to be, now zip code will find her for me. Oh, zip code, please find her for me.
Post office did all sorts of things to try to get you to use zip code. Tomorrow on Classic Radio Theater, we'll get to comedy on your Saturday with Amos and Andy, Jack Benny, let's see, who, my friend Irma, the great Gildersleeve, and Lum and Abner. That will be tomorrow. But right now, Bennett Kilpack, Mr. Keene, Tracer of Lost Persons, and the case of the Rushville murder.
It's time now for Mr. Keene, Tracer of Lost Persons. Ladies and gentlemen, Anison and Kalinos present Mr. Keene, Tracer of Lost Persons, one of the most famous characters of American fiction in one of radio's most thrilling dramas. Tonight and every Thursday at the same time, the famous old investigator takes from his file and brings to us one of his most celebrated missing persons cases. Tonight's case is entitled The Case of the Rushville Murder. This program is brought to you by the makers of Anison, the remarkable tablets that bring incredibly fast and effective relief from the pain of headaches, neuritis, and neuralgia. Anison is like a doctor's prescription. That is, it contains not just one, but a combination of medically proven active ingredients in easy-to-take tablet form. Thousands of people have received envelopes containing Anison tablets from their own dentist or physician. Perhaps you, too, have been introduced to Anison this way. Then you know how effective Anison is. If not, try it yourself. Whenever you want incredibly fast relief from the pain of headache, neuritis, or neuralgia, you'll be delighted with the results. For most effective relief, use only as directed. Just ask for Anison at any drug counter. It's spelled A-N-A-C-I-N. Anison. Now for Mr. Keene and the case of the Rushville murder. Our scene opens in the home of Dr. Prentice, a well-known physician and psychiatrist who resides in the small New Jersey community of Rushville. The doctor's daughter, a tall, lovely young girl, is just reaching for the telephone, which has been ringing insistently, as if aware of the urgency of this particular call.
Hello?
Laura, this is Dad.
Oh, where are you, Father?
At the hospital. But I'm coming right home, Laura. After I hang up, be sure to shut and bolt all the doors and windows.
Why? What's happened, Dad?
One of my patients has just escaped from the hospital. She's a homicidal maniac, Laura, and extremely dangerous.
Father, there was something I wanted to tell you.
Oh, later, my dear. Right now, you do as I ask. This insane patient of mine is under the delusion that I'm her enemy, and she may head for the house immediately. I've already informed the police.
All right, Father.
And don't let anyone inside the house. I'll be home in 20 minutes. Goodbye, Laura.
Goodbye. There. I've shut and locked all the windows. Who's there? Oh, no. No, you're not going to... No. No, don't touch me. Put down that knife. No!
My daughter was found by the police 5 minutes after I had phoned her, Mr. Keene. She'd been stabbed to death with a kitchen knife.
Tell me, were all the windows and doors in your home locked, as you had asked, Dr. Prentice?
No, Mr. Keene. The windows were shut, but apparently Laura never had time to lock the back door that leads to the kitchen before Natalie Craven, the insane patient, reached the house.
Saints preserve us.
Well, Dr. Prentice, your insane patient seemed to head for your home immediately after escaping from the hospital.
Yes.
That's a little odd in itself.
But I told you how this patient felt about me, Mr. Keene. I'd treated her for a mental disorder for 2 years, but she developed a fixation about me and began to feel that I was her mortal enemy.
Well, you were devoting your time to bring her back to sanity.
Yes, Mr. Keene.
But what I meant, Dr. Prentice, is this. You were in the hospital at the time of the insane woman's escape. Now, if she wanted to murder you, why didn't she attack you after you left the building? Why did she come to your home instead and attack your daughter?
The mind of a psychiatric reacts in odd ways, Mr. Keene. This woman, Nettie Craven, may have thought I'd left the hospital. Then, finding I wasn't at home, she must have attacked my daughter, Laura, to revenge herself on me.
Oh, I see what you mean, Doctor.
since the death of my wife, Mr. Keene, there have been only two things in my life, my work and my daughter, Laura. Laura is gone now, but I still have my work, and I intend to carry on.
Naturally.
I don't want Nettie Craven punished for the crime. She's completely insane. But she must be caught and returned to the hospital before she claims another victim.
You, for instance, Dr. Prentice?
Oh, I wasn't thinking of myself. I'm thinking of others. That's why I've come to you, Mr. Keene. The police are on the case, of course. And if an investigator of your ability also enters it and works along with them, the woman will be captured all the sooner.
I intend to do everything I can, Dr. Prentice.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Keene. Needless to say, you'll be doing a great public service.
Yeah, but we're also thinking about you, Dr. Prentice.
Oh, please don't worry about me, Mr. Clancy.
Well, if you don't mind, I'd like to do a little prescribing in this particular case, Dr. Prentice. Where is your home?
In New Jersey, a town called Rushville. Well,
Rushville's just across the river.
That's right, Mr. Clancy.
Dr. Prentice, I'd like to exchange house keys with you. I'd like you to stay in my apartment until this case is over. And Mike and I will stay in your house.
But my work, Mr. Keene, my practice...
Well, it'll be better for you to miss a few days' work now, Doc, than to end up with no work at all.
You mean you think Nettie Craven will try to make me her next victim?
If this insane woman killed your daughter, yes. I insist that you take these precautions, Doctor.
Well, in that case, I'll do as you ask, Mr. Keene.
Fine.
And be careful yourself. I needn't remind you that a homicidal case like Nettie's is most dangerous.
Well, I'm aware of that, Dr. Prentice.
There's just one thing I'd like to add, Mr. Keene. If a young man named John Digby calls, try to break the news of Laura's murder as gently as possible. John is Laura's husband.
Her husband, eh? Was he living in your home too, Doctor?
No. As a matter of fact, my daughter Laura had just come back to my house the day before. She and John were married only a month ago. They had a childish quarrel.
I see.
Oh, it was nothing at all, Mr. Keene. John's a fine boy, and I was certain I could have patched things up between them.
You tried to notify him of Laura's death, didn't you, Dr. Prentice?
Yes, but I couldn't reach him anywhere.
Very well, Dr. Prentice. You can proceed to my home immediately. I'll notify the hospital you won't be available for a few days. Meanwhile, Mike and I will bend every effort to put our hands on this Rushville murderer before another victim is added to the list.
Well, the light switch must be on this wall here, Mr. Keene, sir. Oh, here it is.
Well, Dr. Prentice seems to have a very comfortable home, Mike.
Sure, and it's too bad he lost his daughter. It's pretty tough for a man to go through something like that, Mr. Keene.
Yes, but he still has his work, and he's one of the best in the profession. If we can...
Boss, just a minute. I thought I heard someone move around the next room.
Yes, you're right, Mike. There's someone here. Open that door.
I'd better have my gun handy, just in case.
Who are you?
Stand where you are, mister. Don't move.
What are you, thieves?
No, young man. We happen to be working with the police.
The police?
What are you doing here in Dr. Prentice's home?
Come to talk to my wife.
His wife? This must be young John Digby, boss. Laura's husband.
How did you know my name?
Your father-in-law, Dr. Prentice, told us about you, John. My name is Keene. This is my partner, Mike Clancy. May I ask how you got into this house?
Why, there was a kitchen window open. I didn't want to ring the front doorbell because I thought that Laura wouldn't let me in. We'd quarreled like a couple of silly kids, and she'd left me. I've come back to apologize to her.
Saints preserve us, but he hasn't even heard.
Heard what?
Sit down, John.
What is it? Why are you both looking at me like that?
Where have you been for the past 2 days?
I was so miserable after our quarrel, I went to a little town near Philadelphia.
That explains why you didn't learn of the tragedy.
What tragedy?
It's going to be a shock, John, so prepare yourself. Your wife, Laura, was murdered.
Laura murdered?
By a maniac.
No. No, I don't believe it.
It's true. And I'm sorry. One of your father-in-law's patients, an insane woman, escaped from the hospital. And they think she attacked your wife.
I should never have let Laura leave our apartment. It's all my fault, Mr. Keene.
Sometimes fate works out things in her own peculiar way, John.
And you think it was that maniac who killed Laura?
Well, that's the general opinion.
Well, it isn't my opinion.
What do you mean, John?
Mr. Keene, a few days ago, Laura was troubled by something important she wanted to tell her father. She started to tell me about it when I got home. But I interrupted her, and that's when we had our quarrel.
You don't know what it was that worried your wife?
I can guess. We fought because I was jealous, Mr. Keene. Jealous of a man named Arthur Halliday.
And who is he, John?
He used to be a medical student at the university in town. Dr. Prentice is a member of the examining board in that university. The board that passes on a student's character before he's permitted to graduate as a doctor.
Yes, go on.
Halliday drank a lot. Gambled. The examining board found out and dismissed him from the medical school. They decided he was too weak to accept the responsibility a doctor must take.
You say you were jealous of this Arthur Halliday?
Yes, Mr. Keene. He used to see a lot of Laura before we were married. The other day, I saw them together on the street. She never told me she was seeing him. Now it's beginning to be clear to me. Halliday was probably trying to use Laura's influence with her father to have himself reinstated at the medical school. She refused, and he made a threat. That's what she wanted to tell her father, Dr. Prentice, about.
Well, you don't mind my saying so, John. You're taking a lot for granted.
But it is worthwhile looking into, isn't it, Mr. Keene? If I ever find out that Arthur Halliday was responsible for Laura's death, I'll...
Well, you look a little pale, young fella.
News is too much of a shock for him, Mike. Would you like to lie down inside for a while, John?
Yes, sir. I think I'd better. I'll be all right, Mr. Keene. I just want to be alone for a few minutes.
I'll answer that, Mike.
Is Dr. Prentice in, please?
No, not at the moment.
My name is Maud Craven.
Craven? Mr. Keene, she must be related to that insane patient who escaped.
She's my sister, sir.
Come in, Miss Craven. My name is Keene. I happen to be looking for your sister.
Mr. Keene, the famous investigator? Who? You won't put Nettie in prison, will you, sir? She doesn't realize what she's doing.
All I want is to return her to the hospital where she belongs.
I know they're looking for Nettie. They think she murdered the doctor's daughter, Laura. I came here to tell Dr. Prentice how unhappy it made me when I heard about what happened.
You know where your sister may have hidden, Miss Craven?
If I did, Mr. Keene, I'd call the hospital. I know how dangerous Nettie is. I don't want to give her the chance to do to someone else what she did to poor Miss Laura.
Excuse me for a moment, please. Hello?
Dr. Prentice?
He's not in at the moment. Who's calling, please?
Arthur Halliday. When will I be able to reach him?
Why, very shortly. Is it important?
I'll say it's important. To me, anyway. Who is this?
A friend of the doctor's.
Well, you can give him this message. He's kicked me around long enough. Because of him, I can't get into a medical school in the country. And if he doesn't stop hounding me, I'll square accounts.
Hello? Hello, hello?
Who was that, Mr. Keene?
That was Arthur Halliday, Mike. A young medical student John Digby told us about. I wish I could have gotten his address.
But if he was a student in the town university, they can tell you where to reach him, Mr. Keene. If you want me to, I'll...
What is it, Miss Craven?
Oh, the window.
Sans preservis. There's someone outside, boss.
Yes, she's staring in the window.
Look at that face. She looks like an animal.
It's Nettie. It's my sister.
Grab her, Mike.
Mr. Keene.
Isn't she there?
There's no one in sight, sir. She's disappeared like a ghost, boss. It's too dark out here to see where she went.
She couldn't have gotten far, Mike. Something tells me she's still close by. Come on. We're going to search every inch of these grounds.
In just a moment, we'll return to Mr. Keene and the case of the Rushville murder. Meanwhile, beware of unpleasing breath that breathes between the teeth. Use Colonos toothpaste with dental floss action. Those crevices where food particles can decay must be reached for a clean mouth, welcome breath. Colonos toothpaste gives you dental floss action. That is, sends thousands of cleansing bubbles to help dislodge bits of food that can cause unpleasing breath and decay. Colonos is dentist recommended. cleans teeth bright, keeps breath right, and listen, listen. Now save 31 cents on Kalinos toothpaste in the new giant economy size. Go to your dealers today. Take advantage of this great bargain. Save 31 cents on new giant economy size Kalinos. Get Kalinos toothpaste today. Now back to Mr. Keene and the case of the Rushville murder. Mr. Keene, the great investigator, and his partner Mike Clancy are investigating the murder of Laura Digby, the married daughter of a well-known physician, Dr. Prentice, who's attached to a hospital for the insane. One of the patients, an insane woman named Nettie Craven, escaped from the hospital, and she's the one who is under suspicion for the crime. Now, Mike and Mr. Keene have just seen Nettie's face peering in through a window of Dr. Prentice's home. And as they search the grounds for her...
She was standing right over here, Mr. Keene, near this window.
Yes, she was, Mike, but I don't see any footprints.
It's starting to snow, boss.
Well, we better go back inside the house. Maybe Nettie Craven managed to slip away after all. Mike?
Yes, boss?
Come over here for a moment. Look at this.
Why, it's a pair of doors leading right into the ground.
No, it doesn't lead into the ground, Mike. It probably leads into the cellar of the house. Some of these old-fashioned houses have cellars built this way. See if you can open it, Mike.
Well, I'll try. No. No, it won't budge, Mr. Keene.
Betty must have bolted it on the inside.
You think she's hiding in there?
Yes. By now, she must be somewhere inside the house, Mike. Here, let me have your handcuffs.
Here you are, Mr. Keene.
Put these handcuffs through the rings on the cellar doors. Lock them from the outside. There we are, Mike. Now she won't be able to get out the way she came in. Now let's go back inside the house and find her.
Mr. Keene, did you find my sister, Nettie?
Not yet, Miss Craven. We think she's got inside the house through the cellar.
She's in here?
Why, you're not afraid of your sister, are you?
I don't know, Mr. Keene. I used to be able to reason with Nettie, but lately she's been so violent.
You better stay right here in the living room while we make a search, Miss Craven. First, Mike, we'll phone the police in the hospital and tell them to send help.
Well, here's the telephone, boss. It's funny.
What's the trouble, Mike?
Sounds like the phone is dead.
Just a minute. Let's see where the phone wire runs to. Goes to this wall, then runs along the woodwork to the window. Open up the window, Mike.
Well, Mr. Keene, the phone wire has been pulled right out of the outside wall.
Mike, this window faces the side of the house where we saw Nettie Craven.
Well, then Nettie Craven must have pulled the phone wire out just before she went through the cellar doors, Mr. Keene.
There's a car coming down the driveway, Mike.
Yeah, but he's not coming all the way, boss. He's stopping on top of that small hill where the driveway goes up and turns out to the main road.
That's peculiar.
Now he's put his headlights out.
Mike, search this house. See if you can find Nettie Craven. But be careful.
I will, Mr. Keene.
Get hold of John Digby to help you. I'm going outside again and see what our latest visitor is up to. Who's there?
Who are you? My name is Halliday.
Arthur Halliday, the medical student?
The ex-medical student. If it wasn't for Dr. Prentice, I might have been practicing now.
If your character had been what it should have, Dr. Prentice and the school board wouldn't have stood in your way.
You must be the man I talked to on the phone a few minutes ago.
That's right. My name is Keene.
Get out of my way. It's Prentice I want to see.
Now, just a moment. Do you happen to know that Dr. Prentice's daughter, Laura, has been murdered?
Laura? Murdered?
You didn't read about it in the papers?
I just got back from New Orleans. I tried to get into another medical school down there, but they wouldn't have me. That's Dr. Prentice's fault, too.
When a man has a bad reputation, it travels fast, Halliday.
I'm not asking you for your opinion, Keene. I asked Laura to help me, but she wouldn't. So I decided to take matters into my own hands. Now get out of my way before I shoot.
I had a feeling you were rather stealthy about your movements. Parking your car up there in the hill. And sneaking down Dr. Prentice's driveway in the dark. That gun you have seems to bear me out.
I'm going to get square, see? Prentice is my enemy. And if it's the last thing I do...
Look out behind you, Halliday.
Don't try and trick me.
Your car, it's running wild.
What?
Jump, Halliday. Put him over here on this couch, Mike.
Easy now.
His car rolled down the hill and smashed into the house after hitting Halliday. I don't think he's seriously injured, just stunned. I managed to push him partly out of the way.
Well, Mr. Keene, how could a man be dumb enough to park a car in a hill with his handbrake off?
The brake was on when I left it.
Did you hear what he said, boss?
Yes, Mike. That means someone deliberately released that handbrake, hoping the car would roll down and kill the two of us. Where are John Digby and Maud Craven?
Here I am, Mr. Keene. What's happened?
This man's been hurt, Miss Craven. Where have you been?
I heard a noise upstairs and I went up to investigate. I hoped that I might be able to reason with my sister Nettie and save you trouble, Mr. Keene.
You haven't left this house?
No, Mr. Keene.
Where's John Digby, Mike?
Well, he wasn't in that bedroom where he went to lie down, boss. So I started to search the house by myself, and just as I started down into the cellar, I heard the car crash and I ran up. Fans preserve us. What was that?
Mr. Keene, sounded like my sister, Nettie.
Sounds like an insane person, all right.
Enough to chill you to the marrow. Just listen to her.
It's coming from the cellar, Mike. Come on, let's get down there immediately.
Mr. Keene, stay where you are. For heaven's sake, don't move.
It's John Digby, boss.
Nettie Craven standing behind him, Mike, with an axe in her hands.
Yes, I'm Nettie Craven. Don't move, either of you.
Do as she says, Mr. Keene, or she'll bury that axe in the back of my head.
Nettie, why do you want to harm John Digby?
Who are you?
I'm a friend of yours, Nettie.
Are you?
Won't you put that axe down so we can talk?
I can talk with the axe in my hand. Where's Dr. Prentice?
He's not here, Nettie.
It's all they ever do is lie to me. Where is he?
I told you, Dr. Prentice is not here.
Tell him his patient's here. Tell him the most beautiful patient he ever had is waiting for him.
She's as mad as a hatter, Mr. Keene.
Mad, am I? I'll show you who's mad!
Nettie, wait. I think you're very clever, Nettie.
There's a man with sense.
How long have you been hiding here in Dr. Prentice's house?
None of your business.
Do you know that it's snowing very hard outside?
Snowing? Wasn't snowing when I came in.
No, you'll need rubbers when you go home, or you'll catch a cold.
Yes, I will.
Wouldn't you like us to take you home in a car?
Big car?
A very big one. Where do you want us to take you?
I want to see Dr. Prentice.
Why?
I don't know. I had a reason. I forget it now.
Nettie, do you want that ride?
In the car?
Yes.
Yes, I'd love it.
Then put the axe down.
She dropped the axe. Grab her.
Let me handle this, John. Nettie, did you kill Dr. Prince's daughter, Laura?
I never killed anyone.
But you once threatened Dr. Prentice, didn't you?
Nettie? Nettie, what are you doing down there?
Maud! It's my sister, Maud!
Oh, thank heaven you found her, Mr. Keene. Is everything all right?
Yes, Miss Craven. Mike, you have an extra pair of handcuffs, haven't you?
Oh, you're not going to handcuff my sister Nettie, are you?
No, I believe I can handle Nettie with a little psychology. We're going to handcuff you, Maud Craven.
Me?
Put them on her, Mike.
What for?
The murder of Laura Digby.
Oh, it's a lie! tried.
A few moments ago, you told me you never left that living room, Maud Craven. Yet your shoes were wet, and I saw snowflakes in your hair. You were outside the house. And you released the handbrake on Arthur Halliday's car.
It was Nettie. She did it.
No, Maud. I know that your sister Nettie has been inside since it started snowing, because her shoes are dry. The one who released that car brake and tried to kill Halliday and me was the one who murdered Dr. Prentice's daughter, Laura.
You can't prove I did that.
No, well, we'll see. There are fingerprints on that brake handle, no doubt. And I have a hunch they'll match with yours.
But I was wearing gloves.
Yes, of course you were. However, that admission is all I needed.
Oh, you tricked me. You tricked me, Mr. Keene, just now the way Dr. Prentice did.
How did he trick you?
I thought he was in love with me, but he was only leading me on.
I knew you fell for him, Maud. I knew it all the time. You used to be there when he came to see me at the hospital to talk to me. I could see it in your eyes. But he didn't fall for you.
That's right, Nettie. Stand up for him. One of the reasons I wanted to get rid of him was because of you. Don't you see, Nettie? Dr. Prentice was the one who said you were insane. He put you in that hospital. You know you hated him.
Mr. Keene, look at Maud Craven's eyes. She looks as crazy as her sister Nettie.
Yes, I know, John. It appears that both sisters are hopelessly insane.
You fool, you idiots! If you tried to turn me in, you'll get what Laura got.
So that's why you murdered Laura. She must have found out about your mental condition and was going to tell her father.
Yes, that must have been why Laura was worried, Mr. Keene.
Exactly, John. Your wife, Laura, found out that Maud Craven was as insane as her sister. But before she could inform the doctor, Maud entered the house and killed her.
Is Maud coming with us now?
Yes, Nettie, she's coming with you. She's going to stay with you in the mental hospital. I think we can take both of them away and consider the case of the Rushville murder as closed.
And so Mr. Keene finds the solution to the case of the Rushville murder. The next time you're suffering from the pain of headache, neuritis, or neuralgia, try Anacin. You'll bless the day you heard of this incredibly fast way to relieve these pains. Now, the reason Anacin is so wonderfully fast-acting and effective is this. Anacin is like a doctor's prescription. That is, Anacin contains not just one, but a combination of medically proven, active ingredients in easy-to-take tablet form. Thousands of people have received envelopes containing Anacin tablets from their own dentist or physician, and in this way have discovered the incredibly fast relief Anacin brings from pain of headache, neuritis, or neuralgia. So next time such pain strike, take Anacin. For most effective relief, use only as directed. Your druggist has Anacin in handy boxes of 12 and 30 and economical family-sized bottles of 50 and 100. The name is Anacin, A-N-A-C-I-N. Mr. Keene, Tracer of Lost Persons, is based on the novel Mr. Keene. The radio sequel is originated and produced by Frank and Ann Hummert. Dialogue by Lawrence Klee. Bennett Kilpack plays Mr. Keene. It is on the air every Thursday at this time. Don't miss Mr. Keene next Thursday when the kindly old Tracer turns to the case of murder on the sightseeing bus.
I still wonder to this day how a guy who was a tracer of lost persons dealt more in murder than anything. Mr. Keene, Tracer of Lost Persons, 73 years ago, January 5th, 1950, here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Up next, Frank Sinatra as Rocky Fortune.
Zip code. During this holiday season, the post office would like you to help them get your mail through faster.
Zip code.
Zip code.
Put the zip on every letter.
Zip code. Zip code.
Your mail will get there better.
It will move without delay. It's the perfect way to get the mail to where it's going. Zip code.
Zip code.
Zip up this holiday season.
It's the easy way. Shop early. Mail early. Use zip code.
Zip code is the sure way to get the mail going quickly, dependably, and safely to its destination. Zip code moves the mail.
Shop early.
Beat the crowds. Get your shopping done early.
Mail early.
Avoid the last-minute rush. Mail early.
Use zip code today. Zip code.
Make a mailman happy.
Yeah, remember they created this character for the post office, Mr. Zip? And in around Christmas season, they put a Santa hat and beard on him. And the rest of the year, he looked like a regular mailman. There you go. Let's see. Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox on a Friday. An episode of Frank Sinatra as Rocky Fortune 70 years ago today, January 5th, 1954, on the trail of a killer.
Frank Sinatra, transcribed as Rocky Fortune. NBC presents Frank Sinatra, starring as that footloose and fancy-free young gentleman, Rocky Fortune.
Hi. You know, it takes a real artist to get real involved. And, brother, when it comes to that art, I'm the original Michelangelo. But I gotta admit, I ask for it sometimes. This was one of those times. I was mad. Mad enough to dream this rack of mine up to 7 feet of steel. Maybe I was just a lox looking for a bagel blanket, but some smooth creep put a permanent curl in my lip. It's not tough to understand when circumstances puts a guy on the wrong road. Slums make monsters out of a lot of good citizens, but when a creep uses education, money, and a decent background to give him a background of crime, this is real slime. This guy wasn't even domestic. We imported him. I met this here gentleman when he was going with a sister of one of my neighborhood buddies. Her name was Ellie. She was fast, frustrated, 40, but it wasn't her fault. She spent her manhunting years looking after five brothers and sisters and heating the Saturday night bathwater on the stove of the cold water flat. I didn't know there was a guy in the picture till we were talking one night.
Rocky, you got a good head on your shoulders. What do you think I should do?
What's with this Dorothy Dix jazz? Do about what?
Well, now that all the kids except Sammy are married, I'd like to get married, too.
You mean Ellie's got a fella?
Didn't you think it was possible?
Oh, come on, honey. I'm kidding. Who said it wasn't possible? The guy who gets you is real lucky. Only I didn't know there was a guy. Who is he? Where'd you meet him?
I can't tell you, Rocky.
So you picked up a guy. That's something
wrong? It's not that. I never picked up a man in my life. Only it's not easy for a girl my age to meet eligibles. I answered an ad.
Ellie, you fell for that routine?
So why not? There's some nice, refined ads you see. Most of them are like me, Rocky. They're lonely. I figured I'd maybe meet a nice widower who wanted somebody to look after him.
But you asked me what I thought. Does that mean you met somebody?
That's right, Rocky. Rocky wants to marry me.
Well, how come your brother Sammy never mentioned this? Doesn't he know about it?
No. No, Rocky, and don't tell him. I know already what he'll say about Elmer.
About who?
Oh, now, don't you laugh, Rocky. His name is Elmer, Elmer Broth.
Ouch.
I met him through an exceptionally well-worded ad. And I consider myself very fortunate. And if you're going to make fun of me, I'm sorry I ever burdened you with my problems.
Now, honey, take it easy. Ellie, you know I love you like you were one of my own. Only you should talk this over with Sammy and let him meet this guy.
Sammy has nothing in common with Elmer. They speak different languages.
What does this guy talk? Hindustan or something?
He happens to be a very cultured and refined gentleman.
So what's a cultured, refined gentleman with so much on the ball doing advertising for company? What's the matter with him?
He's lonely, Rocky. But like I'm lonely. You make people laugh. You got charm. You got lots of friends. You don't know what it's like to sit and have a conversation all by yourself. You sit and you talk to yourself, and then you realize that no words are coming out. It's only your mind can hear you. And you start thinking maybe you're losing your mind. It's a horrible thing to be lonely, Rocky. It's like having a hole in your heart.
Sure, I guess maybe I got a hole in my head, not my heart. I'm sure he's a wonderful guy, Ellie. Sure. I guess you ought to marry him at that.
Thanks, Rocky. Thanks for telling me that.
She thanked me for advising her to marry him. That was almost funny. Because I found out a lot of things after that. For example, I found out why she didn't want to tell Sammy and have him meet this Elmer. Ellie knew she shouldn't marry him. She was afraid Sammy would talk her into being sensible. She didn't want to be sensible. She just wanted to be married. So Ellie got her fella and got married. Sammy wasn't too happy about it. 6 months later, he got the real reaction. You know what that sound is? That's a man crying. Crying his guts out. You know what it's like to sit and listen to a grown man? A guy you grew up with tear himself in two. And nothing you can do about it. Just sit and torture yourself. Bleed. And cry inside with him till finally you can't stand it any longer. Stop it, kid. Come on, stop it.
I can't. Rocky, I can't. I can't help it, Rocky.
What's in you, kid? What is it?
It's Ellie, Rocky. Ellie's dead.
I'll give you the details just like the lonely Mr. Fancy Pants from abroad gave it to the coroner at the inquest.
We had been out visiting some friends. My wife had been kind of quiet all evening. Usually she only takes a single drink. This night she had four or five, and they seemed to depress her. When we arrived home, she said she had something on her mind and wanted to drive and think it out alone. Since it had already been a most unusual evening, I didn't question it. I was tired and had a few myself, so I fell asleep immediately and slept quite soundly. I found her in the morning. Evidently, she had driven into the garage and fallen asleep at the wheel with the engine running. It must have been an accident.
There was no accident. Ellie didn't drink.
This court finds the deceased, Ellie Brunt, came to her death on the night of December 2nd by inhaling carbon monoxide fumes. Death was accidental.
There was no accident. He killed her, I tell you. He killed her, and I'll kill him.
All right, easy, easy, kid. Come on, Sam. Quiet. I finally got the kid sat down, but the damage was already in. Anything happens to Mr. Fancy Pants, and the kid is booked solid for a one-way trip to Sing Sing. I make coffee time with him and try to bring sense to some plan.
I only know one thing, Rocky. Ellie gave her whole life to raising us kids. For herself, she had nothing. All she knew was work, take care of the house, go to the movies once a week. Rocky, sure she wound up with a few grand after the kids got married. She had herself a time.
I know that, Sam. I know your kids were her whole life. And if anything happens to you now, that means she wasted her life.
The other kids got families, Rocky. They can't take any chances. Ellie was all the family I had left. Ellie's dead. And he killed her, Rocky.
The law don't say that, kid. The law says it's an accident. And unless you got proof, you gotta go by the law.
I don't need proof. She was my sister, Rocky. She was all I had. This creep killed her. I got nobody left. Nothing more to lose. Rocky, I'm gonna get him. I'm gonna get him!
Two things told me the kid's words were Emma's. The look in his eye and the bulge in his coat pocket. Sammy was a fighter and a rough-and-go kid, but he never packed a heater. So I had to get to Mr. Fancy Pants and get him to leave town before Sammy killed him. I knew Sammy would take the subway downtown and take the train out to the island where they had their house. Me, with my no-expense account, had to beat him out there. A 15-cent phone call could maybe save me $4 taxi. I invested. Elmer, this is Rocky Fortune.
Oh, I'm glad you called, Rocky. I feel very badly about Sammy. It's horrible enough that Ellie is gone, but can't you possibly convince Sammy that it was an accident?
That's why I'm calling you, pal. I can't convince Sammy. We better do some talking right away.
Well, that's fine. Can you come out here?
Wouldn't do any good. You're having company, and you better not be home when the company gets there.
What you mean?
I mean Sammy's on his way out, and he's liable to want some target practice for the heater in his pocket. You could be the target. That's all I had to say. 20 minutes and one speeding ducat later. It's open.
I got here as quickly as I could.
I noticed. Sit down and listen to some news, Mr. Brough. Tune in real close because there ain't going to be a second time.
I'm awfully sorry to do it, Rocky, but if Sammy actually has a gun, I shall be forced to go to the police for protection until I leave town.
Where are you going?
Well, I don't know yet. There are too many memories around the house and around the town. You know how it is.
You know, Elmer, somehow I got no tears for you. I think you're a rotten liar. You got Ellie's insurance, you're selling the house, and you're blowing town. A nice, pretty, convenient package.
So you think as Sammy does.
Don't put words in my mouth, Mr. Brough. I'm liable to spit them back at you. And I'm getting mad. I'm getting real mad just looking at you. You just gave me the whole bit. I think Sammy's right. What would a fancy pants like you want with a 40-year-old sweetheart like Ellie? Why would you marry her?
I married her because I loved her.
Nice try, but no cigar, Mac. You married her for the $10,000 or $11,000 you're in line for.
I won't bother denying anything to you. There's no reason why I should. Ellie's case is closed by the police.
And aren't you real lucky? So Ellie's case is closed, and off you go with the loot. Let's just get a repeat performance on what happened, huh?
I already told you the entire story to the police, and the case is closed.
I just now opened it, Mr. Brough, and I just might open your head.
Take your hands off me.
Stop making with the Shakespearean drama. I'm only making sure you're sitting in that chair and not running to the cops. Not till you satisfy one question that bothers me.
There's no reason for me to have to satisfy you.
It hurts that I should have to disagree with such a distinguished man, but sit still or I'll beat your brains in.
Oh, what do you want to know?
Now you're getting smart. In my head, I've been running over the details. Now, in the first place, like Sammy says, Ellie never went much on the liquor kick. And even if she did get loaded and did fall asleep in the garage with the motor running, who closed the garage door?
Why, I don't remember that it was closed.
You told the coroner at the beginning of the inquest that it was closed.
Yes, I suppose I did.
So I get a picture of Ellie getting out of the car, closing the garage door, getting back in the car, and falling asleep. Something's wrong with that picture, pal.
Well, I didn't want to bring that out, but it bothered me, too. I know what happened, but I didn't want to harm Ellie's memory. She must have committed suicide.
Why didn't the cops say that at the inquest?
I've no idea. There's no use digging that up, Rocky. You can only harm Ellie's memory.
The man's worried about Ellie's memory. That's real touching. It also stinks. That felt real good. That felt right.
Get something straight, Rocky. I can defend myself.
You better get something straight, buddy. If I'm right, you're gonna have to.
I'm not going to sit here and have myself set up either as a punching bag for you or a clay pigeon for Sammy. I'm getting police protection while I'm in town.
If you go near the cops, I go to the insurance company and tell them you told me Ellie committed suicide. There was a double indemnity on that policy, and I'll bet you collect double because it was ruled an accidental death.
What do you want me to do?
That's better. I'm calling the shots now, Mr. Fancy Pants, and I'll level with you. I tell Sammy nothing because if I do, he's sure to kill you. That helps nothing. You're going to remove yourself from the local scene as of right now. And I'm going to get you, mister, and I'm going to do it nice and legal. I want you in one piece and very healthy. I'm going to see to it that you get an extra special crew cut and a drape shape with a slit pants leg. We got no case now, but one day you're going to be happy to turn yourself into the cops. Because that's the only way you'll ever get away from me. Make your plans, mister. Play your traveling music because you're traveling fast and I'm walking behind you. While Fancy Pants gets set for his trip, I call my pal, Sergeant Hamilton J. Finger of the local Gestapo. He verifies what I already know. You need fact to hold a guy for murder. The cops don't play hunches. He gets one bright idea and he figures the pattern is pretty set. Could be Bruff worked the same gimmick back in the old country. He'd run a make through Scotland Yard. Finger reminded me of something else. If Mr. Bruff is a killer, I stand to lose something mighty important to me. Namely, my life. With the financial aid of those who lose their heads easily, I'd get set to travel. Bruff buys the drawing room to Los Angeles 2 days later. Figuring I'm as good as him any day, I buy the same style. Two days later finds us leaving Chicago. I keep low at first, and then accidentally on purpose, just as he's ordering dessert in the diner. How do you spell cyanide, pal? I want to order some dessert for you.
What's the idea, Rocky?
I told you I was working a mustard plaster deal on you. Figured it was time I showed.
What do you want now?
I want to know how you got Ellie so loaded that she sat still while you killed her.
I didn't kill her.
I know, you said that. She committed suicide. Ellie actually committed suicide when she married you. Only you helped to get to the burying stage.
Now, look, Rocky, I'll make a deal with you. You're a young chap. You never had too much money. If you call off this insane chase, I'll give you $5,000.
$5,000. I'm flattered. So you're that afraid of me?
Get something through your head, Rocky. Physically, I'm not afraid of you. This much I'll admit. I married Ellie because I needed the money, her money. I may even have made her slightly unhappy. Unhappy enough to commit suicide. I may even have made her suicide look accidental so I could collect on the double indemnity. But you have proof of nothing. Now be clever. Take the $5,000.
Do you know what Sammy would do to you if I ever repeated this conversation again?
Well, you won't do that. You protected me against Sammy simply because you knew he'd kill me and would have to pay for it. In the eyes of the law, he would have killed an innocent man.
I wonder what would stop me from killing you. I hate you enough to carve your guts.
You better be careful, Rocky. I may just grow to hate you that much, too.
That's when I was sure I was looking into the eyes of a cold-blooded murderer. And he was looking into the eyes of the guy he wanted most to kill. Hey, that's me. Like a flash, it came to me that for a change, I was running off of the mouth much too much. The next stop the train made found me making a collect call to one Sergeant Finger.
As soon as I heard the call was collect, I knew it was you, Rocky. You still with Bruff?
Like chewing gum on a baby, only I got a feeling I may be sorry, Finger. This guy's a killer.
I know. How long a stopover where you are?
Only a couple of minutes. Why?
Well, never mind now. There's no time. Listen, I just got word back this guy's wanted in more countries than money. Three dames had fatal accidents, and he was married to them when they had their accident. Now, we got orders to grab him right away, and I tell you what. You have the train held, get the police immediately, and don't you try anything yourself.
What am I using for authority? My chicken inspector's badge?
Yeah, that's right. And if he gets wind of anything, he'll skip. I'll tell you what. I'll rush a wire through to your next stop. It'll verify your story. And when you get to Ogden, you show the wire to the authorities and have them hold them. Then call me.
Now I'm working for the cops. What's with the loot, pal?
Talk about that when you get back.
If I get back. I was one nervous Joe when I got back on the train. Here I was back to back with a killer, and I set myself up as a kingpin in his bowling alley. I spend my time keeping a make on my neighbor and my ear glued to the compartment wall between us. I'm concentrating on the sound next door so much, and the lullaby of the rail starts ushering in the Sandman. I fight to stay awake. I lose the fight. A A little later, I shake myself awake, happy that I still can. A telegram from Finger. This I need quickly. I could have slept through the delivery, so I ring to find out.
Yes, sir, Mr. Fortune. There was a telegram for you.
Where is it, son?
Well, I started to knock at your door, but the man in the next compartment said you were asleep and didn't want to be disturbed.
My neighbor told you that?
That's right. He said I had a telegram in my hand and...
And you gave him the telegram for me?
Well, I always see you both together, so I figured it would be okay.
By now, he knows the whole story.
Did I do wrong?
Man, you just gave me a one-way ticket to paradise, only who wants to be an angel?
I'll go get the telegram from him.
By now it's in pieces. Where are we? How soon do we get into Ogden?
Almost there, sir. About 10 minutes.
Happy to see you off and about, Rocky.
Yeah, I'm tickled to death myself.
Let's get some air.
Who needs it?
Excuse me, sir. I got some things to take care of.
We both need it. For a smart laddie, you make some stupid mistakes. Do you realize you've actually prodded me into killing you?
Nice of me, wasn't it? Look, Brof, use that gun and you'll have the whole train on your back in a minute.
Oh, I realize that. I also realize that if I get rid of you before we hit Ogden, there'll be no one to call the police. Most of the passengers are asleep and there'll be no one in the observation car.
I don't need a diagram, Mr. Accident Specialist. I didn't need a diagram. I was scheduled for a fall. And this time there wasn't even a dame involved. It was a short hike to that observation car, and he was right behind me all the time with a gun in my ribs. The trip back was uneventful. Didn't meet a soul and couldn't make a thing happen. Nothing there but a club car, a bar, and no drinkers. Suddenly, the rear doors open and my future has arrived. My future home, that is, nestled between two shining steel rails with cinders for my pillow. The man finally made a noise.
Turn around, Rocky. I said turn. That's it. Now start backing towards the guardrail.
It happened. I saw it happen, but I didn't believe it.
No.
Drag him inside, boys.
Yeah. Drag me with him, boys. I don't think I can make it alone. I don't know where you guys came from, but I'm sure happy to see you.
Well, we've had the front, middle, and rear of the train covered since you left your last stop. We were hiding behind the bar when you walked through the club car.
How did you know about it?
Got a call from Sergeant Finger. He was afraid Bruff would try to kill you before you reached Ogden. We couldn't tackle Bruff while he had the gun in your ribs. When he got you outside, the noise made it possible to sneak up on him without being heard or seen.
Why didn't that idiot Finger tell me he was having a train boarded? I just lost 10 years of my life.
Don't be rough on that idiot Finger, Mr. Fortune. His call saved your life.
Yeah, get your antenna set to receive some news, pal. I love idiots. From here to eternity.
NBC has presented Frank Sinatra as that footloose and fancy-free young gentleman, Rocky Fortune. Others in tonight's cast included Paula Victor, Tom McKee, John Sutton, Barney Phillips, J. Loft Lynn, and Maurice Hart. Tonight's script was written by Norm Sickle. Andrew C. Love directed. To tell you about next week's adventure, here's Frank Sinatra as Rocky Fortune.
Next week, I'll tell you about the time I got hired by the rodeo just before someone shot the boss and rustled the gate receipts. I ended up with a six-shooter in my back and an invitation to be guest of honor at a Western fashion show, modeling an 18-foot necktie made of rope.
If you're a driver who likes to travel at night because the highways are less crowded than in the daytime, you're courting danger and should be extra careful. Although fewer cars travel the roads at night, The death rate per vehicle is four times greater at night than in the daytime in proportion to traffic volume. If you must travel at night, use the utmost caution. Most of all, slow down from your normal daytime driving speed. The two biggest factors causing an alarming increase in night accidents are bad driving vision and excessive speed. Safety experts say that more than 20 million motorists have bad driving vision at night. About 3 million have vision so bad at night that they are dangerous when they drive. Now, you may have the vision of an owl after dark, but your number may be up if you drive too fast or become involved in an accident with one of these drivers with extremely bad night vision. Avoid driving at night whenever possible, and at all times drive as though your life depends on it. It does. Visit with Fibber McGee and Molly tonight on the NBC Radio Network.
70 years ago, January 5th, 1954, Frank Sinatra as Rocky Fortune here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Comedy tomorrow with Amos and Andy. Suspense, My Friend Irma, The Great Gildersleeve, and Lum and Abner. Coming up next, Broadway Is My Beat.
Friends, this is Jim Amici. As we in California know, forest fire's a terrible thing. It robs us of lumber, takes away outdoor recreation, ruins hunting and fishing, destroys homes and property. It can spoil livestock grazing and turn the faucet off on your supply of water that comes from the forest. Fire's mean and vicious, but it can be stopped. Stop before it ever starts. Here's what you can do to help. 1. Crush out your cigarette, cigar, and pipe ashes. 2. Break your matches in two after you use them. That way you'll be sure they're dead out. 3. Drown your campfire with water, then stir it and drown it again. 4. Find out all you can about your local and state laws before you use fire outdoors. Please be careful, folks. It's up to us to keep the forest green and productive. Let's all remember what Smokey Bear says. Only you can prevent forest fires.
Now on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox, Broadway Is My Beat, starring Larry Thor, produced by Elliot Lewis, from 72 years ago, January 5th, 1952. This is the John Dobson murder case.
Broadway's My Beat, from Times Square to Columbus Circle, the gaudiest, the most violent, the lonesomest mile in the world.
Broadway's My Beat, with Larry Thor as Detective Danny Clover.
In the first week of the new year, Broadway is beside itself with promises. The new leaves have been turned over, the resolutions made, and the wife has been kissed in the morning. It's the time of only one martini before dinner, the high-protein diet, and let the blonde stroll by without lifting your hat. Also, it's the week of the clearance sales, goods slightly handled and non-returnable, but at a bargain. So buy something, live it up. It's 1952, the year the boat will come in. It's got to be the year. And in the corridor where I was, the new year was a thing that came and went, paced off by the quiet steps of nurses, a corridor of routine and pain, emergency hospital.
Danny? You got here fast, Danny.
What's the trouble, Dr. Sinsky?
Come on. Report that came with the man said his name was John Dobson.
Can he talk?
No.
How bad is he?
Well, I'm doing everything I can. In here. One thing, he's not in any pain. There's a report over on the table with his effects.
Huh. John Dobson, Park Avenue address. Found in comatose condition in a parked car on East River Drive. Motor still running, 8:20 p.m.
40 minutes ago, Danny.
What's the matter with him, Doctor?
Poison.
Uh-huh. Carrying a lot of money. Over $300 in his wallet.
I've got saliva samples down in the lab, Danny. Until then, I have to treat symptoms. Can't tell what kind of poison. Maybe self-administered.
I doubt it. You ever hear of anybody drinking poison and going for a car ride? I'd say the man was driving when the poison hit him, pulled over to the side,
that's
and
that's your business. Pardon me, Danny. I've got mine to do.
And the shadows gather, wait on the edge of the circle of light that is a yellowing barrier against them, holding from them the man, locking from them his life. The shadows wait for a night's decision to be made. The beggars of darkness, eager for the handout of death. And working quietly within the fortress of light, Dr. Sinsky, aware of the hunger of shadows, moving quickly against them to deny them a man's dying. Watch it, then leave them alone with it. Go now to the Park Avenue address of John Dobson. Be told that his wife is at home. Ascend to the 30th floor apartment.
Where does it have to be before it penetrates? There's no one home.
The woman's anger tears at her heavily creamed face, intensifies the smallness of her eyes. The only color, the pale, thin lips like an old scar.
Get out before I have you thrown out.
I'm from the police, Mrs. Dobson.
I don't care who you are. You've no right to come here, to wake me, to make me show myself this way.
Your husband's in the police emergency hospital. He's been poisoned.
Come in. You could have phoned, you know.
That's true, we could have.
Then you wouldn't have seen me like this. In a way, you're privileged. Few men have ever seen me in this. Even John. He has his own bedroom.
Maybe it didn't register, Mrs. Dobson. I said your husband has been poisoned. He's in the police emergency hospital.
Of course I'll go to him, if that's what you're implying. If you'd only phoned, I could have worn a proper... Well, now I'll just have to throw on the first thing that... How bad is it?
He's dying.
The blow that crushes you, say, for a finish, right between the eyes. Is that how it's done?
It crushes you.
I love him. That answer your foolish question?
He was found in a parked car, alone. You know where he was before that, Mrs. Dobson?
With me. We had a candlelight dinner here in the apartment. Over a dessert, he kissed me full on the lips. Said he had to go out for the evening. It was hours ago.
Did he tell you where he was going?
Well, he whispered it against my ear. To his old friend, Floyd Gilmore. John and he exchanged old school ties for Christmas.
Where do I find him?
Floyd? He has a devastating little flat in Gramercy Park, done in bachelor's souvenirs. The longer you keep me, you know, the longer it'll take me to get to John's side.
I'll drive you down, Miss Dobson.
I want to be lovely for him. That'll take a while, so you won't bother waiting, will you? Of course you won't.
What kept...
Oh. Yes, what is it?
Your name Floyd Gilmore?
Well, yes, what's...
I'm Danny Clover, police. You mind if I come in?
Well, what for?
It's about John Dobson, I understand.
What about John?
Something's happened to him. He might die.
Yeah, you better come in. In here. He might die?
He's been poisoned. He was found a while ago in his car.
John?
I just talked to his wife. She said he'd been with you.
John never got here. Well, what's the matter? Don't you believe me?
What was he coming to see you about?
I ask you something. Don't you believe me? I told you John never got here.
I asked you something, too.
He was coming over to see me, that's all.
What for? To borrow a book, play chess, what?
You can take fingerprints, mister. I'm telling you, John wasn't here.
That's going to be pretty tough to prove, Mr. Gilmore. John Dobson had plenty of time to be here, be poisoned, and leave.
Be poisoned? You mean be murdered?
If John Dobson dies, it'll be murder.
I'll tell you why he came here.
Came here? You said he didn't.
All right, so I got mixed up. I got a quirk. I get my conjugations mixed when I'm under mental stress. Well, you want to listen to me, or you want to call me a liar and arrest me? Do what you want, mister.
Go ahead, tell me your story.
I had a friend I wanted John to meet.
Mind if I ask why?
John doesn't get along with his wife. She didn't approve of his outside interests.
You were going to introduce him to an outside interest?
Well, this girl, this friend of mine, is a nice kid. Same kind of personality as John.
Oh?
That's right.
Pretty?
Sure. This friend of mine was, well, fetching's the word. Not as pretty as Edna. Not nearly as pretty as John's wife.
What?
I could never understand that about John. The beautiful wife like Edna, all her dough. Why, he had so many outside interests. Why, he should...
Where do I find this friend of yours?
Oh, Isabel? At the New Howard Hotel. Ask for Isabel Martin, mister. Oh, and tell her I'm sorry. Tell her we couldn't make it tonight.
At the New Howard Hotel, a discreet brownstone in the discreet East 60s, designed to recall the foamy days of Victorian elegance. The reproductions of antique hitching posts, standing in frozen wonder at the sleek and snarling eight-cylinder beasts flaunting their chrome. And the lobby hung with maroon velvet, its frayed tassels swaying gently over simulated marble. And presiding over it, a frocked man savoring a well-thumbed pocket edition of Charles Dickens. Take courage by the hand. Break through the mists of old lavender. Dare to ask him for Isabel Martin. The consequence is no more than a compassionate smile, a whispered room number, and a ride in a self-service elevator hung with the framed messages of beauty salons and credit dentistry. The elevator finally ascends to the heights of the fifth floor.
Hi there, and hello. You're late. I heard your footsteps in the hall. I opened my door and let out a call. Hi, John.
Not John. I'm from the police, Miss Martin.
Police? Floyd said he'd send me John, and he sends me you.
Yeah.
Where's good old Floyd? I want to scratch his face.
Let's go inside, Miss Martin.
That's a lovely idea. Loveliest idea of the century. Let's everybody go inside. Let's everybody have a drink. Here, take a sip of mine. I was saving it for John, baby. He won't be here. Right for him. You take a sip of mine, baby.
You think you can understand what I'm going to tell you, Miss Martin?
The things this girl understands. I'm not as gone as all that, miss. Lonesome little drinky while waiting clears the brain. So tell me.
John Dobson is dying. He was poisoned.
That's why he stood me up, huh? Because he's dying.
You waited for him. He never showed up, is that it?
That's it.
Do you mind if I look around?
Love it. Love it. Note the tasteful arrangement.
There's another glass here on the night table. Part of a drink in it.
That's where it's been hiding. Come here, lonesome little drinky. I put you down and forgot all about you, didn't I? I poured myself a new one when all the time, lonesome little baby. Pardon me, drinky. Phone drink. Hi there and hello, this was Isabel. Oh, for you, mister.
Danny Clover speaking.
Dr. Sinsky, Danny. Get down here. There's nothing more I can do for him.
Right away, Doctor. Get me an empty bottle, Miss Martin. I'll want to take your forgotten drink with me.
Empties? I got a life full of them, mister. Take your pick.
Dr. Sinsky. How is he, Doctor?
Not a chance. Mrs. Dobson, Danny. She's in there with him. At such a time, you better leave them alone.
Did he talk, say anything?
Once. For a second, Danny opened his eyes and said his wife's name. Said Edna. Said my beautiful wife, Edna.
Beautiful?
Even in all her grief, I caught myself staring at her, watching her. Look. Look at her. Even in all her grief.
The circle of shadows was around them. Around a man and his wife. The man with pale death at his cheek. The woman luminous, her face touched with infinite sadness, of infinite loveliness. A tear at her eye's edge, not falling, but held there. The small glistening of despair.
Johnny. Johnny? John! Doctor!
My dear.
My husband. Dead. Johnny. He's dead. Dead.
You are listening to Broadway's My Beat, written by Morton Fine and David Friedkin, and starring Larry Thor as Detective Danny Clover. Two of our CBS radio gals are at opposite extremes intellectually. Marie Wilson is empty-headed my friend Irma, and Eve Arden is English teaching our Miss Brooks. But in spite of this difference, Irma Peterson and Connie Brooks have two things in common. They're both funny, and they're both yours to laugh at on most of these same CBS radio stations Sunday evenings. Enjoy them both tomorrow night. The new year has doled out only so many of its night times, and Broadway has already used them, drained them of their neon, their glitter, their anguish. Broadway takes its place in line to wait for the new fallings of darkness, as it did on the fading edge of this nighttime that had come like other Broadway nights. It sparked the spectaculars into winking light, had opened corridors for solitude to walk, had carried on its wind laughter and shock. And Broadway stands dazed and still, waiting for this night, too, to end. I was, the night wouldn't depart, because it must linger on the face of a woman, on its beauty, on the tear that held the grief for her dead husband, and must listen close, because her weeping is gentle, distant. Mrs. Dobson.
Oh, don't look at me. Don't dare look at me.
I'll take you home.
There's no need. I'll manage.
If you want to lie down or need something, the matron will...
You have a dressing room?
What?
A room. Something with a mirror in it. A brightly lit mirror.
I suppose there's one somewhere in...
I shock you, Mr. Clover. I shock you because I insist on being beautiful even while Johnny lies dead. Is that something awful for a woman to want? To be beautiful for her dead husband?
I don't know.
You know it now, Mr. Clover. You've seen me ugly. And you've seen me like this. The lovely one is the woman Johnny knew. The woman Johnny saw when he died. There was never any other. You understand that, Mr. Clover?
I think so.
Good. Now leave me alone with him, will you please? I mean alone. No gratuitous sympathizers. No one to see me with tears on my face. Alone.
To you, Danny, a good morning. You slumbered well in the land of Nod, I hope?
Oh, not so good, Gina. I didn't get home from the hospital until late, and then when I finally got to bed...
Well, here's something that'll revive an otherwise drab day, Danny. Surprise.
An electric fan? What for?
Startles you, huh? The self-same fan you commissioned me to have repaired last July. I saved the department money, all fixed and ready to go. To wit. Like Miami.
This is the same...
The same fan by which we have called other names. Motor torn apart to the quick and revived by me, Gino Tartaglia, plus the proto-tools Mrs. T slipped into my galoshes for Christmas. Professional, huh? Feel a breeze.
It's January, Gino. Turn it off. Gino?
Yeah. Any other puttering you'd like to have done around here? Just
Putter the word about the medical examiner's report.
Roger. John Dobson did indeed die from a poison which Dr. Sinsky did label as being of the alkaloid family. Specific poison and time taken will not be known until autopsy is performed on the vital organs.
What else have you got?
Some background material on Mr. and Mrs. John Dobson dug out by obediently yours and the good Detective Mugovan.
If you please.
Indeed. Mr. Dobson lived by no visible means of support. Nice house. Nice clothes. No job. Prior to his exchanging marriage vows with Mrs. Dobson, he lived off handouts from friends.
Go on.
Mr. Dobson did attach himself and married Mrs. Dobson while she was still in widow's weeds.
Oh? Edna Dobson was married before?
To a Timothy French, deceased.
What did Mr. French die of, Gino? Could you find that out?
I did. From an accident. Mr. French was a wheelchair case from his youth. 3 years after his marriage to his wife, he had a misfortune. Fell out of his chair down the steps.
And Mrs. Dobson inherited his estate, isn't it?
Now, wait a minute, Danny. I'll look in these reports. Just take a second.
Well, never mind, Gino. Put them on my desk. You did real fine today.
Just wait till July when you can enjoy that fan, Danny. The nice things you'll say about me.
And study the reports the sergeant leaves on your desk. Find that the widow of Timothy French had inherited $250,000, more than half of it in insurance. Find the name of the insurance broker who had handled it. Jonathan Harvey, 12 Broad Street. Go to him. Talk to him.
Let me make my puny attempt at trying to understand you, Mr. Clover.
Go right ahead.
I'll have to black it out on this scratch pad. Now, let's see. Under a general heading, we have your reinvestigation of the death of Timothy French, Edna's first husband.
That's right.
Then, draw a line, and underneath, your reasons for doing so. What shall we put down, Mr. Clover?
Well, Mrs. Dobson's second husband died last night of alkaloid poisoning.
Newspapers had it at great length. I read the head. Aha! I see what you're after, Mr. Clover.
Thank you.
Now I can fill in this side. Here, we have death of husband number one. Here, death of number two in the short space of 2 years. Interesting.
I'm glad you agree.
However, I'm afraid that's as far as it goes, Mr. Clover.
Oh, tell me why.
Perhaps you don't know that my company conducted a most thorough rundown on Mr. French's death. Found it accidental. Though I'm an insurance man, Mr. Clover, I am also a friend.
Huh?
A friend, a confidant to all my clients. As I was to Tim French, as I would be to you.
You knew him well?
My dear young man, I nurtured his romance with Edna.
How did you do that?
Edna was a teller at the Ruxton Bank on Wall. One day I wheeled him along with me. Well, I made a deposit for him.
And that's where he met Edna Dobson, in the bank.
She was plain then. Thoughtless fellow could call her ugly. And Tim was a, forgive the word, a cripple. Unwanted people. They meet sometimes, fall in love, and get married.
Then one of them dies in a fall.
There you go again, beating your head against a blank wall. It's useless, Mr. Clover. We spent thousands of dollars proving it to ourselves. Tim died accidentally.
So leave there and decide a thing. Mrs. Edna Dobson, ex-bank clerk, widowed twice, was a woman you wanted to talk to again. Go to her apartment house. She's not the home you're told by a maid who opened the door for you and got right down on her knees again to dust. Where is she? She's going to a funeral tomorrow, so she's down the beauty parlor, naturally. Which one? Lawson's, naturally. So thank the maid who waved her feather duster goodbye to you and go to Lawson's. And meet another woman, dressed fashionably clinical in a white jersey uniform, who sits behind a desk and asks questions.
You a husband?
No, I'm afraid not. I want to see...
Oh, boyfriend, eh? Who have we got under the dryer belongs to you?
I want to see Mrs. Dobson.
What have you been doing all morning, man? Mrs. Dobson's been here since 9. Facials, hair set, contouring, refinishing, reweaving, everything on the menu. And you walk in just as she walks out. I don't envy you.
Oh, why?
If you're a fellow who's going to help her through this bereavement, frankly, I don't envy you. Frankly, you don't look as if you can afford it. I'd get fired if mine here Lawson knew I was talking like this. Mine here is Dutch, you know.
No, I didn't.
But I like your face, to be blunt. Mostly because I like men's faces and I hate to see them be suckered.
I appreciate this.
The dough that Edna Dobson spends on lotions and contours and facials since the first day she came in here.
When was that?
I remember because when she stepped in here, mine here said... I accept the challenge. Her first husband's funeral was at noon. Her appointment was at 4.
And since then, she spent a lot of money, huh?
Not only with us. Take a walk down the street to Rexford's. Find out the dough she spends there on clothes to make her look of the form divine. But believe me, save yourself the walk. I know.
Well, I want to thank you for all you've done for me.
Not that I dislike Mrs. Dobson, you understand. Just that I like to be frank. Understand what I mean?
Right in here, Mrs. Dobson.
Oh, hello, Mrs. Dobson. Come in. Oh, sit down.
Sit down? Here?
Well, this is police headquarters, Mrs. Dobson. The taxpayers don't furnish us with upholstered furniture.
Well, it's so dusty.
Oh, Detective Markman.
Uh-huh. Now you can sit down, Mrs. Dobson.
Thank you.
Well, I want to thank you for coming down here to see me.
Did I have a choice?
Well, I didn't want to barge in on you again. I know you like to ready yourself before you meet people.
Thank you again. It was very considerate.
I was telling Mrs. Dobson out in the hall how nice I thought she looked after all she's been through.
He's right, Mrs. Dobson. You do look very lovely.
Thank you. Why did you ask me to come here?
Well, I have a few things I want to talk to you about.
I see.
We were surprised to hear you'd been married once before, Mrs. Dobson.
What of it?
I think it's important that we should know about your first husband.
Know what about him?
How he died.
He died 4 years ago. He fell down the steps in his wheelchair.
Did you push him?
I'm sure there's nothing else you want to say to me.
Did you push him, Mrs. Dobson?
For your information, the insurance adjusters asked me the same thing. If they hadn't reached the conclusion that it was an accident, would I be here?
Sit down, Mrs. Dobson. Look, close the door and sit down. This will only take a few moments. Thank you.
Why did your Mr. Mugovan ask me that question?
Well, you don't have to ask him, Mrs. Dobson. Ask me. I'll tell you why. Because his death left you a rich woman.
Then by your reasoning, every woman who inherits money is a murderess.
You met your first husband while you were a teller in a bank, didn't you? How did you meet your second husband, John Dobson?
Shall I tell you? Shall I really tell you?
If you don't mind, Mrs. Dobson.
I was eating salted peanuts in a bar. He sent over a note and a bottle of wine.
Who paid for the wine?
What?
The lieutenant asked you who paid for the wine.
Who do you think paid for it?
I doubt whether Mr. Dobson did. He was pretty broke from what I could find out.
That's right, he was broke. What of it? I fell in love with him. Not right away, but eventually I fell in love with him.
Mr. Dobson was a good-looking man. I imagine a lot of women fell in love with him.
But I married him.
When did you find out he was running around with other women, Mrs. Dobson?
He's dead. Leave him alone.
Lieutenant asked you, Mrs. Dobson, when did you find out about
it? Leave him alone.
Life?
Leave him alone.
Did he start taking interest in other women when he barged in on you one day like I did and saw you like I did?
What difference does it make?
Well, here's the way we figure, Mrs. Dobson.
I know what you think. You think I killed my first husband and you think I killed Johnny.
I don't think we'll ever know about your first husband unless you want to tell us.
It was an accident.
Well, here's the way we figure, Mrs. Dobson. Your first husband died and you came into all that money. With money, you could make yourself beautiful. Beauty salons, custom dresses, the works. The way you always wanted to be. Isn't that right, Lieutenant?
Then you met a handsome man, a man who believed you were beautiful, John Dobson. He married you. He had no job. He lived off you. You were satisfied with that as long as he believed you were lovely.
She is lovely, Danny. I don't care what you say.
Then he changed. He started to go around with other women. You couldn't tolerate that. You poisoned him.
Did you ever see a woman who could wear clothes like her?
No. No, I haven't.
And the way she does her hair.
Yeah. Beautiful.
You think so?
The reporters will think so, too.
The photographers, too.
There'll be pictures of you in all the papers.
All your exclusive clothes. Every woman in the city will be jealous.
Just when women look at me, I can tell what they're thinking. They are jealous.
There'll be interviews.
And on the stand. All the men. The women. The women crowding the courtroom to get one peek at you.
I killed them. I killed both of them. Will the reporters be here soon?
Sleeping now, the furious avenue of the night is still. It stretches out in front of you, without beginning, without end. The dumping ground of refuse and ashes and leftovers. The neon words are turned off. But look there, where the sidewalk meets the street. It's your name, written on water. It's Broadway, the gaudiest, the most violent. The lonesomest mile in the world. Broadway. My beat.
Broadway's My Beat stars Larry Thor as Detective Danny Clover, with Charles Calvert as Tartaglia and Jack Crucian as Mugovan. The program was produced and directed by Elliot Lewis, with musical score composed and conducted by Alexander Courage. In tonight's story, Idrine Tedrow was heard as Edna Dobson. Featured in the cast were Florence Lake, Gene Tatum, Bill Boucher, and Earl Ross. Tomorrow night, the gal who made good Tuesday nights, Audrey Totter as Millie, joins the Sunday lineup on most of these same stations. Yes, from now on, you can meet Millie and all her hilarious friends, too, Sunday nights on CBS Radio. On the more serious side, tomorrow marks the debut of The People Act, CBS Radio's new series about community problems solved by American communities. You'll find The People Act a fascinating, rewarding experience every Sunday night on CBS Radio, starting tomorrow night. Bill Anders speaking, and remember, those lovable rascals, Amos and Andy, are here every Sunday on the CBS Radio Network.
Seventy-two years ago, January 5th, 1952, Broadway is My Beat on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. We head to Pine Ridge, Arkansas in just a moment and see what's going on with Lum and Abner here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox.
We are the vocal parents of the local PTA. We gather here because we fear that 10 years from today, the younger generation of a growing population will look to us for leadership, will look at us and say, we have no alma maters, with or without swimming pools. We have no alma maters, because we have no schools.
Our children are growing faster than our schools. And 10 years from today, conditions may become desperate unless we do something about it now. If you'd like to do something constructive about it now, write to Better Schools, 9 East 40th Street, New York 16, New York.
We can have the schools we need 10 years from today.
Now on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox, let's get back to Lum and Abner as they get to their new business here, the Lucky Loaf Bread. This from 81 years ago, January 5th, 1942.
The makers of Alka-Seltzer bring you Lum and Abner.
Say, folks, I heard something about Miss Fredericks the other day that I thought would interest you. Miss Fredericks realizes that as Pine Ridge's school ma'am, she has a big responsibility on her hands. It's a big job, teaching and caring for children, and it requires a lot of patience. So she just doesn't take any chances. She knows from experience that she can't be as patient and understanding as she should be when a headache or some minor stomach upset causes her discomfort. Well, that's why she always keeps a package of Alka-Seltzer tablets in her desk at school. Then when she's upset, she just fixes herself a glass of sparkling Alka-Seltzer, and it's almost no time before she's her sunny, efficient self once more. Now, folks, there's a real lesson for you in Miss Frederick's experience. You, too, should keep a package of Alka-Seltzer tablets at your place of work. Do this, and you'll be prepared for quick relief for those common ailments that make you cross and irritable, and can so easily keep you from doing your best work. Try it, won't you? Remember, when you take Alka-Seltzer for headaches, for minor stomach upsets, and muscular aches and pain, you'll feel better fast. Get a package or two of these modern effervescent tablets from your druggist right away, and never be without them handy again, both at work and at home. And now, let's see what's going on down in Pine Ridge. Well, with Mousy Gray's inglorious defeat at the hands of Iron Ike in the carnival boxing match, Lum decided to give up his career as a fight manager and check off the money he spent to experience. He and Abner are now concentrating on their new merchandising plan to promote the bakery. They have baked a silver dollar into one out of every 25 loaves of bread. And today, as we look in on the little community, we find the old fellows getting ready for a big day in their jot-em-down store and bakery. Listen.
Here you are. Now, how's that for an impressive sign, Abner?
Oh, you got it done already. Yeah. Well, let's see it.
Watch out, don't get too close. The paint ain't dry yet.
Win a prize today. Buy Lucky Loaf bread. Just 10 cents a loaf. All right, Dogies, that's a good sign, Long.
Yeah, that ought to get us 1,000 or 100 customers.
Yeah.
Might have to enlarge the store before the week's out. I don't know.
Lucky Loaves. Is that what we're calling the bread with the money in it?
Yeah, I studied that up this morning.
Well?
Hadn't no more than got my eyes all squinted up for a good long spell of thinking when the idea come to me quick as a flash.
Hi, Dogies, that sounds good, you know it. Lucky Loaves. How many loaves did you get baked up this morning, Lum?
Oh, about 150, I reckon.
150?
Yeah, got the whole room full back there. And there's a silver dollar in one out of every 25 loaves. Wait a minute, wasn't that our ring?
I don't know, I never paid no attention
to it. Go ahead and answer that.
Yeah. Hello, Jot'em Down Store, Library, and Pine Ridge Bakery talking.
Might change that to Lucky Loaf Bakery, I don't know.
Yes, Ms. Monroe.
Dollar bread, that wouldn't be bad.
That's right, a silver dollar baked right into the bread. Oh, well, no, not in every loaf.
Of course not, for goodness sake, couldn't afford that.
Just 10 cents. All right, 5 loaves. All right, Miss Monroe, we'll deliver them this afternoon. All right, goodbye.
Did she sure enough say 5 loaves, Abner?
Why, sure.
Granny, now I know we'll make a success out of this. Neither Miss Monroe or Tom, either one, ever ate bread, and here they are buying 5 loaves at a time.
Sure.
I'm afraid we ain't going to be able to keep up with our orders. That's going to be our trouble.
Yeah, maybe you oughtn't to put that sign up, Lum, so folk will just sort of forget about... Wait a minute, who's that? Oh, that's Cedric coming there.
Oh, for goodness sakes, I hope he ain't brung along that bird whistle he went as a prize at the carnival the other day. I'm sick and tired of hearing him blow that thing.
Well, he's more than likely got it with him. He's even going out in the woods now and blows it at the birds.
Well, I don't mind that so much. I wish he'd stay out there and blow it.
Yeah.
Him sitting there in a choir at church and blowing that whistle during the organ solo, so that's going too far.
Mind out. Here he comes. Well, morning, Cedric.
Morning, Mr. Abner. Mr. Lum.
Cedric, we'd rather you didn't blow that whistle in the store.
Yeah, we have to keep it quiet in here on account of the library, you know, Cedric.
Well, I won't blow it, Mr. Lum. I just come down here to meet old, what's his name? We're going out in the woods and whistle at the birds. He's got himself a bird whistle, too.
He has, huh?
Yes, Mom. You want to hear how much I've improved with mine?
No, we don't, Cedric.
Yeah, run along and meet your friend, Cedric. We got a lot of bakery work to do today.
Well, I sure have improved. You recollect how the meadowlark and the whippoorwill both sounded just like the meadowlark?
I never will forget it.
Well, now I've got it to where it's a lot better.
Well?
Now I can do it so as the meadowlark and the whippoorwill both sound like the whippoorwill. Just listen here.
Cedric, now just take that thing and get out of here.
Yeah, Cedric, you'll have to leave. That's all there are to it. We're awful busy today.
Yes, we are.
That was the meadowlark, I think. Now, here's the whippoorwill.
Cedric, now go on home, or out in the woods, or wherever you're going. You can show us the whistle some other time. Go on now.
All right. I'll come back when you ain't so busy.
Yeah, that'll be fine.
Well, I sure have improved.
Well, I'm glad to hear it. Goodbye. Oh, his next thing we know, he'll be trying to grow himself some feathers and sit around in a nest up my tree. That boy.
Granny, when Cedric gets himself interested in something, there ain't no one thing that'll get him off the subject.
Oh, no.
I'd sort of planned to give him a steady job delivering these lucky loaves, but I could see there weren't no use even suggesting it.
No. He wouldn't even hear you.
No. We're going to need a steady deliver man, though, Abner. I can see that. Well, come on, let's get this sign nailed up out in front. Paint's just about dry now.
Yeah, it ought to be. Just a minute, I'll make sure. Uh-oh, oh, no, not quite dry
for
yet, Mom.
For goodness sake, now you got it all smeared. Keep your hands off of that. Wait a minute, let me get the phone.
Well, I just want to see if it's dry.
Hello, jot 'em down store in Pine Ridge Bakery. Lucky Loaf Eddard's talking.
Lucky Loaf Eddard?
Mom? Why, sure. You've got as good a chance to get a loaf with a dollar in it as anybody else.
Changes his name every time we change business.
Oh, no, Mom. We can't guarantee you'll get a lucky loaf, but the bread's worth a dime anyway. How many? All right, Miss Blevins. Well, we'll get it over there this afternoon. All right. Thank you, Mom. Goodbye. Granny, did you hear that, Abner? Imagine a penny pincher like Miss Blevins buying three loaves of bread at one time.
Oh, they're all going to be buying more bread than they need just so they'll have a better chance of getting one with a dollar in it.
Oh, we're going to be millionaires before you know it. Or thousandaires, anyway.
Yes, sir. Now, if you'll just stick with this, Lum, and tend to business instead of getting off on something else like you generally do, why, we're going to make some money out of this, you know it.
I ain't going to get off on nothing else. I've been fooling around trying to find out what I suited for. Grannies, I found out one thing. I'm a natural-born bakery man. I can tell that. The bakery business is in my blood.
Well, I'm proud to hear you
Wait
say it. Huh?
Grannies, I hope he don't come over here.
Who?
Mousy Gray across the street, yonder.
Oh, well, I'll be dog. I'm even surprised to see him up. Having the mumps and being knocked out by that fella who worked the carnival, why, I allowed that to lay him up in bed for a while.
Yeah, well, he had no business fighting a fella like Iron Ike anyway.
Well, you was the one that talked him into it, Lum. Just trying to win that $1,000 that they's offering to anybody that could knock Iron Ike out.
That's right, I was, wasn't
Why, it? Sure you did. You brung it on him yourself.
Well, he ought to had more sense than to listen to me. He ain't no fighter.
Well, he knocked you out.
Well, anybody could... Or lucky punch is all that was. Uh-oh, Granny, he's heading over this way. Dad, blame it.
Well, now, why don't you just tell him, Mom, that you don't want to have nothing more to do with the box fighting business, that we're in the bakery business here, and you're going to stick with it.
I'm going to. Going to. Kind of glad he's coming over now so I can tell him.
Why, sure, get it over with, and then we'll take these lucky loaves and make a fortune out of them.
Done cost me $110, that box fighting business. That's enough for me.
$110?
Why, sure. I bought his manager's contract for $100 from Squire Skimp. And then I paid $10 entrance fee when he fit Iron Ike.
Oh, yeah, that's right. I'd forgot about that. Yeah.
Look at him strut. Morning, Mousy. Come on in.
Morning, Lum. Abner. How are you today, Mousy?
Oh, I feel fine. Except I'm mad.
Mad? You ought to be happy now that you're over the mumps.
Well, I didn't have the mumps after all, Lum. I found out it was just a bad wisdom tooth that was bothering me.
Well, what are you mad about then?
That Iron Ike person. He took unfair advantage of me in that fight, and it just makes me boil.
Taking unfair advantage of you?
Yes, sir. He hit me first.
Well, natural he's going to hit you first if he can. You got to expect that in a box fight. That ain't cheating.
Yes, sir, but I didn't know that. Nobody told me. You know, I believe they deliberately kept that from me. Oh, I never was in such a rage in my life.
Well, it's all over now. I just forget about it, Fuzz, you Mousy.
No, it isn't all over either. I'm going to hit him first the next time.
The next time?
Yes, sir. I found out that carnival is going to be over at Cherry Hill the end of this week, and I've already challenged Iron Ike. That is, if it's all right with you, Lum. I know, of course, that you have my manager's contract with me, and anything you say, I will do.
Well, Mousy, that manager's business, I've give that up. I'm going to be honest with you, Mousy. You ain't got no business trying to make a prize fighter out of yourself. Little feller like you ain't got a chance against the professionals. You're going to fool around here and get yourself hurt.
No, I'm determined to get your money back for you, Lum, every cent that you put out.
Well, now, don't you worry about that. That was my own fault. Let's be sensible about this, Mousy. That Iron Ike's a big, tough professional fighter. You ain't no match for him.
Oh, I just feel sure that I can knock him out.
Oh, Mousy, you better give up that idea.
No, sir, I'm going to fight him, Lum. And if you don't want to be my manager anymore, why, that's all right, but I'm determined to fight him. I heard the carnival went to Odin when it left here, so I went over there yesterday and went up to the hotel where some of the carnival people were staying, and I did it.
Did it? What do you mean?
I just walked right up to that Iron Ike and told him that I didn't appreciate him hitting me first the other day, so I just knocked him out, too, just to see if I could. And then I told the fella that runs the carnival that I'd be at Cherry Hill Friday and do it again.
You mean you knocked out Iron Ike?
Yes, sir.
Well, I do know. Well, you dead blame right we'll be there. With me managing you, Mousy, you're a cinch to whip it.
Well, wait a minute, Long. What about the bakery business?
The prize-fighting business is in my blood.
Well, Lum really changes his mind in a hurry, doesn't he? But he's not the only one, for the weatherman is just as uncertain. One day it's nice and warm and sunshiny, and the next it's dreary and cheery and dull. It's no wonder colds are so prevalent at this time of the year. So be wise, friends, and be prepared. Never be without a package of Alka-Seltzer tablets in your home. For with Alka-Seltzer handy, relief for much of your distress can be yours promptly and pleasantly. Now, of course, you should take other common sense precautions as well, such as getting plenty of rest, eating wisely, and dressing sensibly. But don't forget Alka-Seltzer, because the relief it offers from that dull, achy, feverish feeling of a cold will sure enough be welcome. And if your cold causes a sore throat, use Alka-Seltzer as a gargle, too. Dissolve 2 tablets in a 1/4 glass of warm water and gargle freely to relieve that raw, scratchy throat. Be sure to try it, won't you? The very next time a cold makes your life miserable. Remember, you can get Alka-Seltzer at all drugstores.
They got one good thing going on, and Lum's going to go another direction. 81 years ago, January 5th, 1942, Lum and Abner here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Have yourself a great Friday. We'll be in tomorrow with comedies featuring Amos and Andy, Jack Benny, Suspense, The Great Gildersleeve, and more Lum and Abner. Thanks for making us a part of your day. We will see you tomorrow for more Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox.